name is Ron Weisberger. I'm director of the BCC Holocaust Center. And we're very pleased to collaborate on this program with Luso Centro on this really interesting, fascinating topic. The Holocaust is probably, most of you know, relates for the most part to the Jewish people who lived in Western and Eastern Europe, either the Ashkenazic Jews. What is not as known as, and most of those folks, like myself, second, third generation, fourth generation, so we trace our roots back to that area. But there are another group, perhaps a smaller group of Jews who are the Sephardic Jews. And that's what this topic is about. It's less, they're less known, but their story is very important. And as we'll see, relates a lot to our many of our folks who live in this area from Azores and Cape Verde, other parts. So we're really excited to have Pedro Bacudo, who is has done a tremendous amount of research in this area. We were very fortunate to be able to get him tonight. And we will hear what he has to say about that period in the late 15th century, when Jewish people were forced to either convert, flee, or lose their lives, and we'll find out what happened to them. Just very briefly, the BCC Holocaust Center is a program of the college and supported by not only the college, but also the community. In the area, the Jewish Federation of New Bedford and the Fall River Jewish Appeal and other people who have supported us. And I know there's people in the community supporting Luso Centro. So we're very happy and appreciative of that support. The center, by the way, is located on the second floor of our library. And it's in 200A. We do conferences. We have a conference November 4th, which is sponsored by the U.S. Memorial Holocaust Museum. Any teachers, which will be for middle, high school, college teachers. And we have two programs, which we'll be doing in New Bedford in November and December. One of the presenters, a couple of presenters are here today. We have a conference on the Native American genocide in the spring, plus some other programs. So we're busy. But we also have a resource center on the second floor of the library. Any of you who are interested in the subject, want to borrow books or DVDs, you can come up to the second floor. We're open most of the time. We have my wonderful assistant, Lunel Dean. We have other volunteers. We have Judy Browns here, who have helped us in many ways. So in any case, today is a program we like to collaborate, and we're really very pleased and happy to be able to collaborate with Luso Centro. We did that last year, working together with Jose, who's here in the back there, and with now Carlos Almeida. So just to get started, I'd like to introduce our Vice President for Academic Affairs, Dr. Greg Tesseris, who will bring welcome from the college.
Thank you very much, Dr. Weisberger. It is a real thrill for me on behalf of President Sprague and Bristol Community College to welcome you here to BCC for this event. And it's also a pleasure in particular for me to get to say just a minute worth of words between my longtime friends, Dr. Ron Weisberger and Dr. Carlos Almeida, who head up together two different organizations that bring cultural studies and history to BCC and to the community. And these two organizations, the relatively newly founded Holocaust Center, and I can't tell you how thrilled I was that Ron decided to retire so he could put all of his energy into the creation of the Holocaust Center, the programming that we have had over the last 2 years at Dr. Weisberger's hand has been absolutely incredible. So when he mentions the event on November 4th, Friday, November 4th. Please try to be there for those events. They are spectacular. And also, of course, my friend, Dr. Almeida, who has taken over again relatively recently, the Luso Centro, and I would be remiss if I did not point out someone that I know many of you know in the audience, Dr. Jose Costa in the back row, who started the Luso Centro about 16 years ago. So thank you, Jose, and welcome. So I now get to, as well as welcoming you, and also Dr. Kudo, it was great to have you with us here.
Thank you.
And thank you for being here. And with no further ado, Dr. Carlos Almeida, the director of the Luso Centro.
Thank you, Dr. Sotaris. What a great crowd, isn't it?
Yes.
This is awesome. This is awesome. My name is Carlos Almeida. I'm the director, newly director, relatively new director of the Luso Centro here at the college. As Dr. Sotaris mentioned, we have here Dr. Jose Costa, who was the director of the Luso Centro for so many years, and I was his assistant, and now I'm trying to fill Lynn's big shoes, so that he left. But it is a great honor and pleasure to collaborate not only with the Holocaust Center here in the college, but also with community organizations such as Casa dos Açores, the Nova Inglaterra, who in the person of its president here, Maria Guimarães. Actually, this past weekend, we collaborated in a book launching, two book launchings of Joel Neto, an Azorean writer. And in November 4th, actually, it will coincide with another Holocaust event here, but the time does not coincide. So you can mark your calendars for November 4th in collaboration with Casa dos Açores da Nova Inglaterra. We're going to have a book launching at Casa dos Açores da Nova Inglaterra in Fall River, in South Main Street in Fall River. The author is Daniel de Sá. And it's going to be presented by our own Dr. José Costa and Professor Frank Fagundes from UMass Amherst. So, and the time will be at 7 p.m. And I know now, since I'm announcing the other events of Luso Centro, I know when you came in, you should have gotten this flyer. It's another partnership between Luso Centro and the New Bedford Whaling Museum that we are bringing directly from Cabo Verde, a historian and a novelist, a friend of mine, José Cabral, who will be at the Whaling Museum on November 17, which is a Thursday at 7 o'clock. I would like to also to reinforce my thank you to Lenel Dean, who is the secretary of the Holocaust Center, who has been helping us with all these events, preparing the flyer, making copies, and helping with the years that are outside. Also, I would like to thank all of you, but also the Portuguese media that has helped us reach out to the community, because we like to bring the community, particularly the Portuguese media, o Jornal, Portuguese Times, the Rádio WJFDFM, all represented here. Thank you so, so very much. And this event is sponsored in part by the Camões Institute, the Portuguese Council in New Bedford,
the Division of Humanities and Education and Jewish Federation of New Bedford. I know, I hope I haven't forgot, and I know that you are excited to hear our guest speaker and not listen to me rambling about our next events. So, to me, is with the utmost great pleasure that I'm going to introduce to you, as we say in Cape Verdean Creole, um irmão das Ilhas, a brother from the islands.
Yes.
Pedro Bicudo, and I'm just gonna read a little bit about Pedro. This is just a short. Pedro Bicudo gained international attention as Washington corresponding for RTP. Mastering news production and media management, he became executive director of RTP Public Television in the Azores. Currently, he teaches Portuguese and Lusophone culture at USAID personnel en route to Portuguese-speaking countries in Africa. His deftness in multicultural environments enhances his ability to communicate complex issues and bridge diverse stakeholders. While a specialist in media convergence and ethnic media for the last 4 years, he has also been developing research of history and of ideas in the Atlantic, concentrating on Yankee whaling and the Atlantic dialogue. As a spin-off of this work and correlated with ancestral journey, Pedro Bicudo has been researching the Cristão Novos struggle in the early settlements of the Azores and Cabo Verde. Mr. Bicudo lives in Washington, D.C., and is a regular university guest lecturer. He has taught at UMass Dartmouth, University of Azores, and University Jean Piaget in Praia, Cabo Verde. He holds a master's degree in journalism from Boston, a licenciature in geography from Coimbra, and a bachelor's in geography biology from the Azores. Please help me welcome Pedro Bicudo, who is going to talk about secrets and survival conversos in the Azores and Cabo Verde.
Boa noite. It is an immense pleasure to see so many friends gathering here tonight. We are going to talk about something that for a long, long time has been sort of the hidden side. Some people say the dark side of our culture. I grew up as a Christian Catholic, and I went to catechism sessions, I went to the seminary. I had a very, very formal Christian Catholic education. I never, ever realized that I had Sephardic blood. One day I was researching in terms of old documents in the Azores and some of my ancestry, and I came upon a gentleman that was a registrar in Ribeira Grande, São Miguel, and his name was Vicente Anes Bicudo. Vicente was a new Christian. I had no clue. And I started digging. Vicente had two sons that immigrated to Brazil. Antônio Carneiro Bicudo, Emanuel Carneiro Bicudo. And then I put my contacts in Brazil after them, or after what remained of them. We are talking about the early 1500s. And we managed to locate who Antônio Bicudo and Manuel Bicudo were and what they did. To my surprise, the ones that remained in the islands continued to suffer from this stigma of being new Christian. Because once you are new Christian, all your descendants are also new Christians. And at the time of the Inquisition, they used to call it the purity of blood. So you had the ones that were pure and the ones that were not pure or new Christians. Also called Mahanush. Also called Fitadush. And after telling you this story, I thought that, you know, it should have been a couple of generations. God knows, Ribera Grande, small community. Surprise, surprise. In February of 1700, the Inquisition was in the Azores. And on the registries of the Inquisition, there is another one. Manuel Rapuz Bicudo. This is 200 years later. So the question of being a new Christian, the question of maintaining this tradition, continued for a long time. And Manuel was requesting permission to the Inquisition to apply for a position at one of the courts in the islands. He was denied, because once again, he was a new Christian. 200 years after the arrivals of the conversos. And I would like to share with you that some of these stories, you know, the hidden side, the things that people do not talk about, somehow it is an imprint in our culture. It happens in the Azores, and later on I started realizing that the same exact situation happened in Cape Verde. Not as much in Madeira, not as much in the Canary Islands, but these two kind of opposed in or two distant archipelagos faced basically the same circumstances in terms of this arrival of the so-called conversos or new Christians. I would like to share with you some of the names that we are going to use today. So the name converso, it's the converted, the one that changed from the old religion to this new religion. They were also called new Christian, the descendants. We had also the name Sepharad. Sepharad in Hebrew means Iberia. And Sephardic or Sephardim are the names applied to these descendants of the Hebrew people that came to the peninsula. You may ask, what happened? How come they came all across the Mediterranean and ended up in the Iberian Peninsula? Well, at the fall of Jerusalem, on the year 70 after Jesus Christ, the Romans took prisoners to the peninsula, to the Iberian Peninsula, and they stayed there for, you know, centuries. And of course, they started developing new rites, new practices, new even new ways to pray and new interpretations of the Old Testament and of the holy books of the Hebrew people. And they started even developing a new language. Not the Yiddish anymore, but the so-called Ladino. When I was a kid, if someone was called Ladino, that would be a smart, sharp person. But if someone was called Judeo, this was a very bad thing. So you can see the two different, the sort of the opposed views here. Judeo, it's bad. You don't associate. If you are a Judeo, it's all the bad things that come after it. You are stingy, you are, you know, sort of, you play around with people, you are somehow good with words in order to turn people around. This is the sort of concept of what a Judeo is. There is even a word that my grandmother used to call Judeirant, errant Jew. And she used to call me Judeirant because I came to the United States. So we are sort of a bunch of Judeirant. My father used to share a lot of our ancestry with me. He did not know. He was the one Bicudo. He did not know. Even my cousins in the Azores still today, they are somehow uncomfortable with the fact that, you know, we are descendants of new Christians. even though we have gone through a process of democratization, especially after 1974, and we accept, we are so much more acceptant in terms of the differences, still today the stigma continues. And people keep looking at this Jewish question as something that either we should ignore or not talk about, or, interestingly enough, you can talk about. If you are Jewish from the ones that arrived from Morocco, also Sephardim, but from Morocco after 1820. So the ones that came to the islands, escaping the Manuelin edict, basically at the end of the 1400s, these people do not talk about. As a matter of fact, if you want to research more about it, the sources are tremendously limited. Almost no reference about this question of identity or hidden identity that people continue to develop.
So life.
I guess it's me. So I'm sorry for, I'm all wired. If FBI knows that, you know, I carry so much microphones, they will be paying me double. At the same time, I have to be very careful with what I say because they are taping everything, and God knows, one day. So I have some information here that I would like to share with you and try to synthesize some of the things that I mentioned to you. And I'm going to try to blow it a little bit more so we can be able to read. Yes, please help me. I don't know what's... Oh, it's this one. Okay, good. So I'm going to basically refer some of these dates, and I hope that you can see it now. So 1427, something happened. The islands of the Azores were found. They were not discovered. The Arabs knew, and even other peoples knew, of the existence of the islands in the middle of the Atlantic. So the Portuguese were the first taking control of the islands. There was no discovery. We, in Portuguese today, we refer to it as achamento. The same applies to Cape Verde, same concept. In terms of Cape Verde, it's even more interesting because, you know, a lot of the Western African peoples knew already of the existence of the islands. The arrival of the European, strangely enough, is considered to be the discoverer. Same way that, you know, Columbus discovered America. Could you imagine if it was vice versa? If America discovered Europe? That would be quite an interesting proposal. So, 1427, the Portuguese managed to not just locate, but also to come back and forth, and from them on started to develop a plan to settle in the islands. The islands were very important at the time as sentinels in the middle of the Atlantic. We can compare the Portuguese and the Spanish at the end of the 1400s as what happened during the space race. Both the Castilians and the Portuguese were trying to cross the Atlantic or to go around Africa to reach India, the source of all the spices and, you know, precious materials that came to Europe in a very expensive manner because they had to be transported by land and then they had to cross the Mediterranean and of course with a lot of middlemen, and the products would come to Europe at a very, very expensive price. So being in the middle of the Atlantic, it was extremely strategic for the Portuguese to control that space and somehow surveil what the Castilians were doing in terms of trying to reach the Indies coming to the west. In 1457, the same happened with Cape Verde. In order to get to Cape Verde, to the islands of Cape Verde, they first had to surpass a couple of very important capes. But once again, Cape Verde, originally, it's in the coast of Africa. The islands of Cape Verde are the islands in front of Cape Verde. If you visit Cabo Verde, you will be surprised. Many surprises in Cabo Verde. I can share you my own. I got there and I was shocked. I felt at home. I could close my eyes and I was in the islands, in my island. And then I started talking with people, friends that became brothers to me, and Irmão. They call me Mon-Jacques Branco. Mon-Jacques, it's everyone that is not from Cape Verde. Branco, white. Mon-Jacques Branco. And to me, it's an honor to be a Mon-Jacques Branco. But I started realizing that there was so much similarities. And I tried to understand why these similarities exist. And with time, I realized that we do share a common ground, that it's not just about living on the islands. It's about a common ground in terms of history, a common ground about being colonies. And we should use words as it, what it means. It means colony. The Azores and Cape Verde were colonies, especially at this time. And people escaped from the kingdom because they were being prosecuted, and these new lands were being offered for settlement. So after the edict of King Dom Manuel, the Manuelin edict, people started realizing that, okay, we cannot survive here. Let's try to survive in someplace else where the sort of controlling of the church and the institutions of the church will not be as strong, as intrusive. So they, little by little, started moving towards the Azores, towards Cape Verde, towards Brazil, towards the United States at the time. The British colonies, the first synagogue in the United States. It's here in Newport, Sinagoga Toro. It's quite interesting. Some came towards the Atlantic, others came down to Africa, basically to Morocco, it's very important. And also others went to the Eastern Europe and spread all over Europe. And some of them were very important, namely in Amsterdam. There was a Portuguese colony, a Jewish colony in Amsterdam that was very, very important. So after this process of basically discovering that there was a possibility of going to new land, this group of new Christians thought that they would be comfortable and safe. Well, something else was happening in Europe. At the time, in the northern part of Europe, a new movement of ideas started. A gentleman by the name of Martin Luther started writing about reforming the church, reforming the way we used to think about basic values. And the so-called Protestant Reformation started in the northern part of Europe and spread very quickly. So now, the Portuguese that were very much conservative, fundamentalistic, Christian, Roman Catholic, they had a new pressure on top of them. And it helped create a so-called Inquisition, a Santa Inquisição. And they created a tribunal, a court, basically to judge heresy. And this court managed to establish branches that would visit, not permanently, that would visit and inspect what life was like in the Azores and even in Cape Verde. So even if you moved out of the kingdom, moving out of Sefarad, you would be under control. It's interesting that the ones that moved out of the islands, that settled in the Azores and Cape Verde, they started developing rituals that were not exactly Jewish, they were not exactly Catholic, something in between. Because if they were too much towards the Catholic side, they would lose their identity. If they were too much on the Sephardim side, they would be in serious trouble. So this in-between, this hidden identity, it's definitely the strongest imprint that we today perceive as a resilient mark of this group of people. The same happened in Brazil. We could extrapolate to Brazil. And it's interesting to see that in Brazil, you have, especially at the beginning in the colonial time, you had two different areas of settlement. The immigrants, the ones that were somehow associated with nobility, used to go to Rio de Janeiro. The ones that were trying to escape the control of the church used to go to São Paulo. And somehow today we understand, I had a Brazilian historian that was kind to explain it to me, to understand the sort of rival position that comes from that time between Cariocas and Paulistanos, the ones from Rio and the ones from São Paulo. So a lot of this new Christian identity moved to São Paulo and generated a new type of commercial activity, specialized occupations, which is another trait of the new Christians. The new Christians followed a tradition of the Sephardim. It was not a good thing to own real estate. Because if you own real estate, you cannot move quick. You cannot run away. You can be easily spotted, and they can control you. The powers can control you. The church could control you. So the best way of surviving is you learn a trait. You develop, you know, a manual capability or an intellectual capability. You work on things that you can easily take and move from one side to the other. And you can produce your own products. You are not dependent on other people. So this idea of independence, this idea of creating your own space, your own occupation, your own capability to produce, it's very much another trait of the new Christians in the Azores and in Cape Verde. I mentioned reform. It initiated a counter-process, the so-called counter-reformation. And this counter-reformation was associated with the response from the Pope and the Catholic Church in order to avoid or sort of control this spreading of new ideas. As you can see, between 1545 and 1563, this counter-reformation process took place. Once again, it's about contradicting, it's about limiting, and it's about also reform of the Catholic Church, but against the principles developed by the Reformation on the north. And at the end of the 1500s, you basically had two Europes, the northern European countries that adhered to the Reformation, and the southern Europeans that were very much with the Christian Catholic and with the Pope. In the middle, the ones in the middle were in war, the 30 Years' War. And it took them until 1648 to somehow find borders and find ways to, thank you very much, Mark, find ways to all live together. Once again, every time there is pressure, every time there is a strong nationalistic identity, usually the minorities suffer the consequences. So this is a permanent situation in history. Every time you have strong powers, every time you have a very nationalistic movement, minorities are the ones paying the price. It's very interesting. The other day I was talking with someone of political science, and he told me, yes, democracy, it's about the rule of the majority, but the most important thing are the minorities. You can indeed say that there is democracy if you respect the minorities, because the rule of the majority is something that we assume and take it as, you know, starting point. And once again, every time you have a nationalistic movement, you have minorities that will suffer with it. It happened with Isabella and Fernando. The king of Aragon and the Queen of Castile married in Valladolid. And by marrying, they united two kingdoms in the Iberic Peninsula. And immediately they started thinking about this concept of Spain. Spain did not exist. There was no reference of this name before the wedding of the so-called king, the monarchs, the Catholic monarchs of Spain. So they started this movement, a nationalistic movement, and one of the first steps was to start eliminating minorities. We want one country, Spain. We are going to unite all the different countries in the peninsula. And we want one religion. They ended up on 1500 expulsing all the Muslims from the south. They tried expelling all the Jews, and most of them ran away to Portugal. Step two, we have to get this Portuguese king married with a Spanish princess. And part of the contract is you have to expel or mandatory make them convert. That's what happened. King Manuel, a very powerful king, but by marriage, he accepted on the contract to expel or order the conversion, the forced conversion of all these Hebrews that lived, the Sephardim that live in the peninsula. Once again, we are going to move a little bit towards front. We are going to have question and answers at the end. I don't want to, you know, to prolong too much on the historical details. Just to give you another important information in terms of what happened, you know, how did it somehow came into a phase down. Marquês de Pombal, the Marquis de Pombal. Marquis at the time was the strongman in Portugal. We are talking about roughly mid-1700s. And in 1772, he came up with different reforms. First, eliminate the state within the state, the Order of Jesus. So the Jesuits were, you know, even though it once I have to recognize that they are a tremendous force in terms of teaching, learning, but they were victims, and for political reasons. Marquês de Pombal was not very much interested in finding out if it was, you know, fair or unfair. He was interested in establishing a solid control over the institutions. And he saw the Jesuits as somehow a kingdom within the kingdom. And with this very strong reform started something else. He decided that indeed a good way to attract businesses was to eliminate this thing of new Christian, old Christian. So he was the one basically creating a more tolerant environment for the new Christians that in 1772 still were called Cristãos Novos, to the point that today we still even refer to this tendency as Cristã Novice. And of course at the time, Cape Verde and the Azores were part of this process, and in the Azores something very interesting started. And this process of change somehow created a positive environment for a few years later, the Inquisition to end. So in basically 1821, the Inquisition had very little power at the time, from the 70s to the 80s, but on 1821, it was the extinction of the Inquisition. Interestingly enough, this was the time when the Sephardim that were settled in Morocco started coming to the Azores and to Cape Verde. So the Jewish presence in the Azores have two complete different times. One, the new Christians that settled in the beginning in the islands. And then on the 1820s, after the end of the Inquisition, after the Pombalin reforms, some of the families immigrated, Sephardim immigrated to Morocco, started coming to the islands, to Azores and to Cabo Verde. Names as Ben David, Ben Ross, and in the Azores, Ben Saud. These are all names that are from this time, 1820. As a matter of fact, most of them, most of the families that came, towards the end of the 19th century, they left to other areas. It's interesting to see that the 1800s is a very interesting time. So you had the somehow the Pombalin reforms sort of settling. And then in 1830, you had civil war. The civil war, it's another story that we need to somehow revisit, because the winner took control of everything, and the, you know, we have a civil war version in Portugal and in the United States. That is the version of the winner. And in history, we have to look at the, you know, both sides in order to try to understand better what happened at the time. So in the Azores, in 1830, we had this invasion of and the ones that defended a more constitutional power. And Pedro, the emperor of Brazil, was in somehow, was the leader of this movement against the brother Miguel, that was supposed to be the one succeeding King Don Juan. Pedro won, and he brought a lot of reforms. And also, once again, reforms in terms of civil liberties, in terms of religious freedom. And it made a huge difference. So you have the beginning of the 1800s, you know, after the Pombalin reforms, the end of the Inquisition, the Civil War bringing more tolerance, more liberties, it created a positive environment. So it's no wonder that some of these Sephardim that were in Morocco decided, why not go to the Azores? Why not go to Cape Verde? And they did, and they settled. And still today, we have descendants of this time. Of course, 1910, it's also an important date for another reason. In 1910, the Republican Revolution basically was the end of the monarchy, and with this came the end of such a intertwined connection, powerful connection, between the church, the Catholic Church, and the political power. Of course, for a very short time, because in 1928, once again, the so-called Estado Novo reinstated this connection between state and religion, and it sort of came back to the old concentration of power, and all the minorities suffered with it. So we talked about Sefarad, Sefardim, conversus, anusim. Anusim, it's a reference that frequently shows up. Anusim, it's interesting, it's the vision of the other. We say conversus. Anusim is conversu for the Sephardim, the ones that continued with the religion. Maran, it's totally, you know, the appreciative. Crypto Sephardim, the crypto Sephardim, once again, as I mentioned, is the continued practice on the cover of some of these basic principles, religious principles, and not only, that remain, some of them remained until today. Fitado, it's also a name referred to the Cristão Novo. Ladino as the language. And it's so important to talk about Ladino because today there is a resurgence. And the Instituto Cervantes is doing a great job in terms of bringing up Ladino. And of course, if Cervantes can do it, why not Instituto Camões do something similar? For a very basic reason, it's not to revive the language, but it's to somehow recognize this common ground, this heritage, and this rich heritage. At the end of my presentation, I'll show you a report from the National Public Radio in terms of this resurgence. Okay, we spoke in terms of this prosecution and forced conversion. And once again, the program of Lisbon also was extremely important for the decision making of leaving Sepharad and moving to the Azores, Skipford, and other, the so-called New World. I already spoke about this Reformation and the Counter-Reformation. The importance is that it created, once again, an added strain on the ones that were not Christian Catholic. Eu tenho que apagar, porque senão a gente vai continuar a ter aqui coisas que não... Muito bem. Okay, we also mentioned the question of the purity of blood. I mean, this is, it's quite an amazing concept. The ones that are pure and the ones that are impure by blood. Not by anything that you did wrong, no. Blood. Your parents. And whatever your parents were or did, you will pay. And your son will pay. And the son of your son will pay. So it's tremendously discriminatory. It's an amazing process that kept going on for more than 200 years. And of course, because it went on for so long, we still today, and this made an imprint in Cape Verdean and Azorean cultures, still today we can and we are finally looking at these processes, social processes, mostly, as something that we have to understand and to analyze within a scientific approach, in terms of sociology, in terms of cultural studies, in terms of history. And different people are devoted to this process, and they are indeed coming up with new materials, new interpretations, and it's quite amazing to look at what we are within this new understanding, and somehow realize what we are as a continued process of change. I would mention some of the work that has been done. One, and I want to not forget someone that was very dear to me and very dear to some that are here, Fátima Sequeira Dias, a nossa Fatinha. She was such an incredible dynamo of energy, of positiveness, of risk-taking. And she was one of the first in the Azores to clearly go front and try to understand why we have been hiding all this process. Why? What happened? Let's try to rebuild our history. Let's try to understand this sort of dark side. Dark because it's not enlightening. Let's try to enlighten. Let's try to bring light into this process, and let's try to understand what we are within this perspective. And she was very provocative, very bright, very strong scientifically, but someone that indeed we should refer as one of the first. She was a pioneer, and she left an amazing, an amazing amount of research done. Very recently, there was an exhibit in her memory in Ponta Delgada. Fatinha, she departed, but she still is with us. That's what I feel. And the ones that had a chance to know her know what I mean. Once again, we are dealing with historical demography. What do we do in historical demography? We look at the same way that we can forecast what will be the future. What, let us say within 5 years, what the United States will look like. We can take the population, we can sample, and of course techniques are applied, and you can somehow project, make projections. Projections are always fallible, but tendencies, patterns are detectable. Well, the same way that we can look towards 5 years, 10 years from now, we can look back As a matter of fact, some people say that demographers say that it's easier to reconstruct in terms of demography than make projections. And they have been doing so. And it's quite interesting to see that associated with this, there is another scientific approach, which is in terms of the genomics, in terms of studying the human genome and trying to find out what genes we could identify as predominant genes in terms of our community. They basically sample, and once again, sampling determines patterns, doesn't determine an absolute value. But it's quite interesting to see that we can somehow trace back our ancestry by tracing back the genome. A lot of people have been doing this, and this is another area that we have been very, very aggressive. The University of the Azores have been working very hard with this. And as of now, we can, once again, I have to tell you that Napoleon used to say that we have three ways of lying. We have small lies, middle lies, and statistics. So, okay, so with statistics, you can say that, you know, it's a beautiful day, but, you know, it's a terrible day. It's a, you know, of course, I'm sort of playing with the concept. Statistics are a tremendous instrument of analysis, and it can indeed provide a vision in terms of patterns. And we can today, and some of the latest studies in terms of the human genome give us an idea that in terms of the ancestral origin of the Azorians, we are talking about between 6 and 10% of the population traceable as Sephardim. Yes. In the Cape Verdean population, the situation is very similar, but the studies that have been developed have not been as aggressive. In Cape Verde, they are interested in different areas. I have to tell you, I'm very much surprised with the advancement of the Cape Verdean society and what they have been doing. If you visit Cape Verde every 5 years, you do not recognize where you were before. Not just in terms of universities, but in terms of infrastructure, in terms of development. It's an incredible country. And, you know, the ones that said that, no, you cannot be independent because you will be always dependent, they managed to say the opposite. And they are doing it.
Let's give ideas.
No, I'm just recognizing the tremendous power, the tremendous work that they have been able to produce, even in terms of democracy. They have been able to change from, you know, the single party to a multi-party system, and they have, you know, gone back and forth. As a matter of fact, they recently elected a government that is not, or the so-called MDP, Viment para a Democracia. That is that was the opposition party when PIAGC or PIACV, that's another war, was in power. It's very interesting. If you have a chance to visit, please do so. I could not recommend more. And be attentive to, especially to the Ben Ross, to the Ben David, to the Ben Rassus. I've met some of these folks, and once again, I had no idea. I'm good friends with Ben David, the son of the coach that went to the Azores. He's a drum player, and he's a great guy. I never thought that he would be, you know, Sephardim, a descendant of converted. Another thing that I would like to mention to you is the Azores is producing tremendous tools for research. And these tools are available on the internet. If you would like to, if you would like to find out more about your ancestry, you can access the originals of the baptism, of the marriage, of the death certificates directly on the internet. It's an incredible tool. And once you start digging, you will discover amazing things about yourself and about your family. I've been talking for a long time, so I'm going to try to come to term. And basically, talking about the Sephardic cultural studies in Portugal and the United States, we have in the United States the University of Washington, Washington State, not Washington, D.C. We have good Washington and bad Washington. I'm not saying which one is which because I live in Washington. but in University of Washington, there is a center. You know, I'm always amazed with the kind of work that they are producing. At the Strom Center, I have a website, and if you have a chance to, you know, Google Ladino University of Washington. It's incredible what they are doing. It's amazing. You know, and it's certainly, you know, a great studying point in terms of trying to learn more about this process. Also, in Lisbon, a Cátedra de Estudos Sefarditas Alberto Bienveniste. Incredible. It's incredible what they are doing. I mean, they are constantly coming up with publications, people from political science, from history, from sociology, from ethnolinguistics, constantly producing new materials. So, I mean, only if you don't want to learn about, because it, you know, the materials are available, and certainly they are tremendously challenging and interesting. And I think that this question of the Ladino resurgency and the ethnolinguistics, once again, we are so much in our schools, in our universities, we are so much dedicated to the question of language and the question of culture. I would like to tell you that, no, we are not all Jewish. That's not the point. Some people say, oh, no, Jewish studies, they want to, you know, stamp everyone as Jewish. No, it's not the case. You know, what we are looking for is to try to understand what we are, where we do come from, and if there was a part of us that was somehow hidden, we want to learn. We want to know. It's, you know, I guess it's a basic right, and I believe that we can certainly be much more in harmony with ourselves if we are able to understand where we do come from. That simple. I would like to share with you a report from the National Public Radio. Let me see, I think that we can.
To be there.
94-year-old Ankyla Pipano was born in Salonika, a Greek city now known as Thessalonica. When she was a child, it had a large Jewish community made up of descendants of those who had fled the Spanish Inquisition. There was just one Jewish woman in all Salonika who could speak another language. All the rest of them, our mothers, spoke only Ladino, she says. Sitting in her Madrid apartment, Pipano struggles to remember her native tongue. She repeatedly lapses into Spanish. It's hard for her because the two languages are so similar. You know, I do remember things from back then, she says. Like the Great Salonika Fire of 1917, and of course, the Holocaust, which devastated Salonika's Jewish community, along with many other Ladino-speaking communities in the Balkans. Pipano and her husband fled into the mountains, then to Palestine under the British Mandate, and finally back to their ancestral home in Spain. Today, there are an estimated 200,000 people who understand at least some Ladino. That's according to the National Ladino Culture Authority in Israel, where most of them live. But there's been a resurgence of interest elsewhere, including in Spain, or Sefarad, as it's called in Ladino. The singer is Viviana Rachel Barnatal. She and her mother, Matilda, broadcast a weekly Ladino program for Spanish National Radio's overseas service. Matilda learned the language from her grandmother, who was born on the Greek island of Rhodes. "We want to show that this is not a dead language," she says in Ladino after a recent taping session. "In killing the people who spoke it in the Second World War, they killed a big part of a culture. That's why we have the obligation to carry it on." The mother-daughter show has been on the air for 20 years. But now the Cervantes Institute, the government agency that promotes Spanish abroad, is setting up a special department to help preserve Ladino. Jorge Urrutia, a director of the institute, says Judeo-Español, as it's formally known, is a link back to the Spanish that was spoken in medieval times. Judeo-Español is a language that has survived 500 years, spanning cultures, geography, and the vicissitudes of history. Naturally, the Cervantes Institute had to do something, he says. The Institute has been sponsoring Ladino readings and seminars at its branches in Tel Aviv, Istanbul, and Sofia. Now, Ladino will be a focus of a new Cervantes Institute in Thessalonica that will be located next to the city's Sephardic Museum. The hope is not that people will start speaking Ladino, but rather that the language will survive through a resurgence of interest in Ladino poetry and music. For NPR News, I'm Jerome Sokolovsky in Madrid.
I thank you very much for sharing. It was a pleasure being with you. I am ready to answer questions. Thank you. Go ahead.
I noticed on one of your slides you were mentioning something about traditional versus popular religiosity. And I was wondering, and you had also mentioned something about the Holy Ghost. I was wondering if you could touch upon that a little bit.
Yes, new studies. This was a question mark for a long time. You know, the Holy Ghost as a religious festivity, as a popular religious festivity, no question about it, was original from mainland Portugal and was brought to the Aids or to the islands. And to, you know, when I say islands, it's Cape Verde and Azores and Madeira also. But this, what was not explained was why it sort of disappeared or became residual in the mainland, and at the same time became so strong, so affluent in the islands, especially in the Azores, to the point of becoming sort of a, you know, I would say probably the most important religious festival in the Azores today. And at the same time, the resiliency of this religious process was brought to the United States. And some people say that if you want to study the Holy Ghost, you should come to the United States in order to understand what it was like. And once again, it's great that we have a social process, and social process also encompasses change. In the Azores, you have a very strong religious, popular religious sense. Today it's becoming just religious. Because the official church used to somehow ostracize the festivities in the Azores for different reasons. And once again, we have to go back to the Reform, we have to go back to some of these movements. But only recently, especially after 1974 and after autonomy, you know, the Holy Ghost became what it is today. You know, it's our feast and we celebrate, we are happy with it. And we finally are looking at this tradition with a different approach, an approach that goes back to the new Christians. And once again, the center recently from the University of Lisbon, o Centro Estudos Sefarditas Alberto Benveniste, Once again, if you could Google it, Alberto Benveniste, it's the center. They have, you know, a constant flow of publications, and they have been publishing about this question of interpretation of a sociological, mostly on a sociological point of view, and comparative religion of the Holy Ghost. So I think, once again, today I wanted mostly to share with you what was this hidden side, and what happened, why it was like this, and somehow, you know, comparing Azores and Cape Verde, we share so much in terms of our common ground. But yes, indeed, we could, and we should, include this vision, this alternative vision. As of now, it's an alternative of what the Holy Ghost is in terms of somehow a reminiscence, somehow influenced. But once again, I would recommend you to read, you know, the scientific articles, and then you will be able to probe deeper into it.
Cool. Migrate away from Israel? What was the reason?
Well, at the fall of Israel, I was puzzled by the same question. How come these guys ended up in the peninsula, so far away from Palestine? And, you know, it was during the fall, after the fall. The Romans took prisoners and they basically dispersed as much as they could, you know, the Hebrew people. And they brought a lot of them. They needed them as slaves and as servants during the Roman times in the peninsula.
And they also, the Romans destroyed the temple in Jerusalem in 70 CE, and I don't know, at least 500,000 Jews, I believe, were killed.
Absolutely.
So those that they took, as a matter of fact, isn't there something, a sculpture or something, was Titus carrying the...
There is also, yes, yes. Titus was the, you know, the responsible for this process of destruction of Israel, killing, genocide. What's it? We are always talking about the same thing, genocide.
Yeah, it was genocide. One other thing I was going to ask. You had mentioned at some point that the new Christians were advised, or they decided to learn a trade so that they would... be independent?
No, they were not advised. It was culture, it's about community of knowledge and knowledge about survival.
Yeah.
You go to Portugal or Spain, and you can visit old villages where this Sephardim presence still is visible today, because there is a resurgence, there is a recovering. And you can see that they not only traveled constantly from place to place, to sell products, to buy products, but also they survived with incredible resources of mental capabilities.
Yeah.
They learned things. They basically used their hands instead of buying land, instead of landlords.
Remember, though, for hundreds and hundreds of years in Europe, they were not allowed to own land.
Also.
They weren't allowed to.
You have a point. Yeah, absolutely. They were not allowed before, and as a matter of fact, even as new Christians, they were limited on their civic capabilities. They were considered citizens of second class with limitations.
They were limited, all the way through.
Yeah. My surprise was, okay, one generation, two generations, three generations. We're talking about 75 years, 100 years. And all of a sudden, you have 250 years of new Christian. It's an incredible situation. I mean, and once again, because it endured for so long, it left such a strong imprint culturally.
Well, sir, first I want to congratulate you on this wonderful presentation. Very interesting. I just had a quick question. I was wondering if you're familiar with the work of Carol Castell, who's doing the work on the Gilbertian Jewish History Project, which is an interesting project because here you have a project that's in part financed by the Kingdom of Morocco in a country that has Christians, Muslims, animists, and folks with Jewish background. And I'm wondering if it doesn't speak to two tendencies, two different tendencies. That is, that you have the top tendency to persecute, therefore people have to adjust to that, and the bottom-up tendency, where we have a society that's more tolerant, that, such that that population becomes diffused into the main population, that later on you have to do this resurgence itself.
Absolutely. No, it is, and I thank you very much for bringing upon this the work and these two sort of dual positions. As far as I can, from what I've been reading for a long time, my wife constantly teases me that and my sister-in-law, she's here, they constantly tease me because I spend too much time either reading or with papers or surrounded by, learning so many things that probably I should not be learning. The thing is, the so-called reconquest, and going back to your point, the so-called reconquest somehow opposed two different ways of life, to cultures, to civilizations in the peninsula. The northerners, the so-called Christians, were trying to grow and control territory over the Moors. In the middle, in the so-called no one's land, lived the Sephardim. The primate of the Sephardim was in the middle. And they would move with the advances of one and the other. They will be in the middle because they were the ones bridging Islam with the Christians in the peninsula. This amazing capability to bridge somehow turned into a very popular saying in the Azores, well, in Portugal in general, no meio está a virtude. And I recently was digging into, proverbs and popular sayings in Ladino, in el medio está la virtud. And things start sort of falling into place. We start to understand some of the things that we in the Azores and in Cape Verde, we are very much, capable of bridging. We adapt. We are survivalists. The island is a tremendous challenge. Tremendous. And we managed to survive. And some of us even became independent. No way. Please.
The Moors very tolerant of the Jews. So the Jews migrated with the Moors. We were in Portugal when the revolution was. They really know how to run a revolution. They do it very quickly. Very few people get hurt. But Salazar was the dictator. What was his attitude toward the Jews?
I'm sure that you know the story of the O Consul de Bordeaux.
Yeah.
I think it's quite well known. The so-called new state, o Estado Novo, and Salazar was a very strong politician and someone that defended strong power. I have to tell you, it's an amazing thing. We love and hate Salazar in Portugal. Recently, the Portuguese public television made a contest to try to find out what was the most important, figure in Portuguese history. He won. It's amazing. No, you have to somehow deconstruct this process and try to understand and position things. But nevertheless, Salazar was against any sort of minority rights, any sort of, he wanted one state, one religion, and he was associated, very much associated with the Catholic Church in order to control and use religion as a source, a tool for control. But definitely, the documentary that you, as a matter of fact, it was last week. It's so clear. It's what was the position of Salazar and what happened in consequence of this strong position against any sort of religious freedom or minorities.
I did enjoy your presentation very much. Everything was new for me, except the word Ladino.
Ladino.
Because I remember I was a kid, either my grandmother or grandfather said, Carapaz un Ladino, meaning that he's overactive. That's the only word I remember.
Overactive or smart or sharp or shrewd.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
But look at the opposition. If someone called you Judeu, that was not a good thing at all. So the negative connotation was so strong. I did not know what was, you know, to be a Jewish was like. I just grew up, you know, in a society that sort of imposed me this sort of values and beliefs and attitudes. Ladin was a good thing. Oh, quel rapage en Ladino.
I remember that. That makes me old, oh my God.
No. Please, go ahead, Lourdes.
Two questions. One, you referred to some villages, there's more of evidence of the new Christians. What are those villages, or are they more present in one island versus the other? And my second question is, with the restoration of the synagogue in Punta Delgada, has there been a new interest from these new Christians to reconnect with their heritage?
Okay, let me try to respond to the first one. If you think in terms of the discovery and the process of settlement in the islands, you immediately realize that the two islands that were the ones more looked for or looked upon was San Miguel y Santa Maria. These two islands, during the initial process, were the ones where most of the Sephardim or New Christians settled. Then we have something interesting. With the progress first, with Terceira becoming the religious center, they tried as much as possible to avoid Terceira. But that was an attraction factor. Terceira was a tremendous mercantile center. It was a huge mercantile center in the Atlantic. Every ship coming to Europe, even, you know, from the so-called West Indies, from Castilian or Spanish ships, or Portuguese coming from Brazil, coming from India, even the ones going to England, even the ones going to Amsterdam or to the Netherlands, they used to stop in Terceira. So it was a tremendous source of and possibilities of, you know, doing business, buying, selling. Just a parenthesis. I was once with an historian at UMass, an historian from Portugal, and he thought, "Oh, you are Azorean. La Terceira. The original name of the island Terceira was Island of Jesus Christ." The new Christians hated the name. Let's put it this way. Why? Because we do share the Old Testament. The problem... Okay. So this is the so-called Son of God. It's the problem between the two religions. We do have so much in common in terms of this, you know, the old with the new, even in terms of the new. And now the question of the Holy Ghost, and now they are in semiotics, they are looking at the Holy Ghost, that's something else. So okay, you have three, you have the Trinity, you know, the Father, the Holy Spirit, and the Son. Okay? Which one sort of bridges? You have the Son in one side, it's a no-no, you have the Father on the other. Which one passes from the Old to the New Testament? The Holy Ghost. So you could continue being a new Christian. You could continue to practice some old rituals within the new religion. It was acceptable. No one would.
Is that why they use a lot of candelabra in their processions?
You know, we are talking about something that happened almost 500 years ago. We have to be extremely careful. We have to have a skeptical attitude, fine, but based on evidence, based on proof. If it is not based on proof, it's just an hypothesis. Mm-hmm. It's a very basic scientific attitude. Once again, we do have some evidences. For instance, we tend in the Azores, we tend to continue the practice of you know, lighting candles and keeping a candle light all the time. We have rituals, like, once again, it's sort of disappearing, but even in terms of the relationship between, you know, father, son, and the family at large, asking for the blessing. You don't see this in Portugal mainland. Unless you go to the traditional villages where, you know, the Sephardim used to live. So, São Miguel, Santa Maria were the first ones, and somehow they managed to concentrate initially. But then something happened. With the Inquisition coming to the islands, they ran away to other islands other than Terceira, because they were somehow protected. So what they were looking for was distance, protection, being on their own. And once again, we could ask ourselves, what would I do if I was a new Christian? I'll try to hide. I mean, I don't, you know, and as much as I could to change any sort of birth registry, and they did it. So my son would not be, you know, somehow stamp marked, tainted with this, and for generations. The question of the synagogue, we are talking about two totally different processes. People look at the synagogue with some sort of, you know, they want to know, they want to learn, but I don't think there is interest religiously. No, it's not my perception. People don't go to the synagogue to pray, or they don't, or you don't have conversions, you don't have... As a matter of fact, what you see in Portugal, it's the opposite in every single religion. People, you know, are sort of moving out of the religious field, and, you know, I think it's part of the social process. Sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. I don't know.
You may not know the answer to this question, but they've traveled so far for 250 years. Are there any similarities in music or art that you find as evidence?
Yes, in music we do find, because in ethno music, we are able, ethno traditional music, we have some very good sources, some very old collection of old traditional music. And we do find that two cultures are present in the very, very old traditional music in Jesus. One is Arab, the other one is Jewish. Jewish, when I say Jewish, I'm talking about Sephardim. If you pay attention to the singing, o canto de trabalho in Santa Maria, in the island of Santa Maria, it's incredible. It's you look at that, you listen, and all of a sudden you sort of enter into a different dimension. But the same happened recently. We had concerts of some of the Sephardic groups, musical groups, coming to the Azores. And people were surprised because they sort of knew the music. And, you know, it's back there. It's an incredible thing. Even in terms of food. Mm-hmm. Recipes. I was very much surprised in my grandmother's. My grandmother never said a word about... No, on the opposite. They were so religious. Religious in the sense of Christian Catholic. You know... they used to make couscous. Mm-hmm. Okay. And it's a very refined process of, you know, it's very elaborated and it's time consuming. But it's something I will never forget. You know, it's so interesting the way they build it. And the couscous came from the Sephardim. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
I would like to ask a personal question.
Please.
And then I have some comments. With all your findings about your Jewish heritage, have you all gone back to your roots, or are you still a Roman Catholic?
My answer is no. I have to tell you, I'm neither Christian Catholic nor so far. As a matter, I've been, with time, I became more and more a spiritual person and not a religious person.
Yeah, not with organized religions.
It's not a question of organization, it's a question of dogma. I need to understand in order to believe, in order to...
Okay, my comments are, you mentioned the conversos that you heard about or that you know, the descendants like Ben Ross, and as I understand, once they were converted, they were given different names, like Pinto, Cordeiro, Coelho, Oliveira, Figueira, and so forth, Costa. I grew up with Wanons, Levy, Cohen, Anahori, and Azulay. So those were obvious Jewish names.
Absolutely.
So I think I'll be an example of what you said. I'm both a descendant of a converso on my grandmother's mother's side, and I'm a descendant of a known Jew, Abraham Azulay. I'm only the third generation born in Cabo Verde. I'm not my Jacob. So you have two here. You have two descendants of the Azulay and Ahor, and my cousin Dr. Pinheiro Baza.
Over there.
He had gone from Israel to Morocco and from Morocco to Cabo Verde. You mentioned about the, I was waiting to hear about Terceira.
Yeah.
The Jewish cemetery is in Terceira.
Yeah. But,
even though.
Yeah. It, you know, what you are saying about Cape Verde could be sad, paraphrased, ipsis
yeah.
verbis in the Azores. The names of the families, the ones that became Estrelas, and so on and so forth.
The reason I mention it is because my great-uncle is buried in your Jewish cemetery in the Azores.
Yeah.
And my great-grandfather was buried in the Jewish cemetery in Cape Verde. So it's two brothers. How I found out about that one, there were these doctors from New York, Jewish scholars.
Okay.
Who presented a documentary at the Orthodox Synagogue on County Street in New Bedford, where I've been living for many years. And when I attended that, there was a Portuguese-speaking Jewish congregant of the Tiferet Israel who pointed out a tomb to me. She had escaped the Nazi regime to Portugal, from Poland to Portugal.
She lived in Lisbon.
When she was only 9 years old, this hits home, 9 years old, and she just stayed in Cape Verde for many years. She spoke perfect Portuguese until she went to Canada with her parents. And according to what these doctors presented about the synagogue within a house that looked just like a house with veranda, just like any other house in Cape Verde or in the Azores, but I found it strange that the cemetery would be in Terceira. And they spoke about even customs that we have. I suppose you have them there. Like in Cape Verde, when we sweep a room, we gather the garbage in the middle of the room. Why is that? Because when the Jews clean their home on Friday to get ready for Shabbat, they couldn't just sweep it outside the house because it would be known that they were preparing for that. So they gathered it in the middle of.
Absolutely.
And they also mentioned about the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
There is no base in Catholicism at all. It's represented by the crown that's on top of the Torah scrolls.
Right.
And the scepter that is used to read the scrolls.
Yeah. Absolutely.
That's how they found a way to continue Judaism, but under a Christian name, the Spirit Santo.
Yeah. You know, what you said about Cape Verde, all these customs or attitudes, beliefs, yes, you can replicate the same exact manner in the Azores. You can even find it more sort of resilient in some islands rather than others, but it's alive. The question is, even in terms of the Holy Ghost, it's not just about religion. It's about reinventing a new social order. It's quite interesting. So it gets, you know, more and more profound, and it's quite amazing, you know, how these sort of old ideas present solutions for some of our today's problems. It's incredible. What I would like to share with you is this. I think that having Luz ao Centro, nosso José está aqui, meu querido amigo José, meu querido minha irmã Calu, está aprendendo. Está aprendendo. having Luz ao Centro, with this sense of common ground, with this sense of bridge, with the sense of let's try to understand where do we come from? And of course, my very good friend Ron. As a matter of fact, Ron was you know, if you want to blame someone, blame Ron. If I'm here, Ron is you know, he's the culprit. Because he went to Washington, then I had a chance to talk with him, and from there it sort of kept building up, you know. And one say another one is, you know, this catalysm, cultural catalyst of having Luso Center and the Holocaust Center here at BCC. This is an incredible thing. If it was in some other place in the country, you would need millions of dollars to do this, as they are doing in the University of Washington. Here, things are done with intelligence, with hard work, with tremendous inventiveness. You know, it's incredible. And I have to tell you this. I was sharing with Ron and with some other people here today. There is this new sort of vision of what community colleges should be. And the president has been adamant about, you know, expressing the importance of community colleges. And some of the projects that you guys have been developing here at BCC are resonating in DC. And when we talk about community colleges down there, and we say BCC, oh, these are the guys with, you know, the new projects on energy. These are the guys with growing, even though they have a very small budget, but they are inventing new things. I was very much surprised, because when I lived in Fall River for a while, you know, BCC was just, you know, the college around the corner. And now that I am in Washington, wow, I did not know that it was so important what they were doing. You are doing great things. And I'm very proud to be here today with you and sharing, you know, my research. And I thank you very much for this opportunity.